which moment we would be in now if the Ukrainians hadn't fought.
What they've given us is an opportunity to reevaluate and to get across certain divides and to think about the future. And so that's what I meant. Just to take again this very small example, we would not be here with an opportunity to talk about values, which is our subject, if it weren't for the fact that Ukrainians are fighting now. If Zelensky had not stayed in Kyiv, if Ukrainians had not chosen to resist, we would all be impoverished by that. We would have lost this time. We've been given this time as a gift to speak about who we are and what kind of future we might have. If Zelensky had fled, if the Ukrainians had not fought, we would all be that much more cynical, that much more narrow, that much less capable of talking about how the world ought to be. So, Philippe, that's what I mean. I mean that I think that every second that they resist is like a day for us, and every day that they resist is like a year for us. It gives us time to think as Europeans or as Americans or as people who are concerned about certain values. It gives us time. They've bought us time. And that counterfactual, where they didn't resist, for me is just so dark. It's so dark. But if we lived in a world where those premises were not resisted, we would all be, I think, more cowardly. We would all have fewer examples to look to. Europe would not have this opportunity that it has now to base its moral future on things like resisting imperialism and resisting colonialism, you know, which is what it ought to be based on. Americans would not have this chance, which they are now having, to have a conversation which is not about COVID, to have a conversation which is about Republicans and Democrats are now talking to each other about something for the first time in years. Right? People in Poland in August of 1980 hadn't taken risks. And when I say we're in a similar moment, I think that's true now. The Russian in 1980 and 1981 in Poland, the question was always, will they invade? Will they invade? Will they invade? And they didn't invade. In the end, they had the communist regime in Poland suppress solidarity. Here, they invaded. It's a different they. Russia's not exactly the same thing as the Soviet Union. But this time, they invaded. And without cause, without justification, every justification that's been given for this invasion just makes it worse.
At the same time, it strikes me, what's really startling is that this is a war of stories. There was no realistic territorial problem that Russia had to fix. Ukraine was not an immediate strategic danger. It is about the vision of a united Russia. It is about the vision of a Ukrainian identity not existing. It is really almost a narrative war that, unfortunately, the bombs aren't narrative that are falling. But can you enlarge on that?
So when I think of the pathos, as you describe it, of Volodymyr Zelensky, it makes me think of the pathos of Czechs in 1938. The kinds of things that he is saying are very similar to the kinds of things that Czechoslovak leaders were saying at around the time of the Munich Accords. The difference being, and I think it's a very important difference, that unlike the Czechoslovaks, who did make these kinds of clear statements to their Western allies, the Ukrainians are fighting. Sure. And that is why these addresses that Zelensky makes to Western capitals, Western parliaments, are heard. He has earned the right to express himself in that way by risking his life. And that changes things dramatically. And it brings things, you know, into a realm of conversation which is very familiar in this house. I mean, this by house, I mean the Institute für die Wissenschaft und Menschen. The philosophy with which this project began had to do with ideas of the relationship between risk and truth, right? The truth, you know, Havel, for example, that tradition. truth is what you're willing to take a risk for. Truth is what you're willing to put yourself behind. So that's a certain philosophical tradition which has a certain place in politics, which has been meaningful. And I'm not saying that Zelensky is a philosopher, but he is someone who was, I would say, has earned a right to these kinds of words. And of course the connection that I'm making to 1938 and 1939 is not incidental. The possible comparisons, as you suggest, go much further than that. When I think of this war, I'm not thinking of 1942 or 1943, but I am thinking of 1938 and 1939. And in particular, picking up on something that Serhii mentioned, in particular this language that another state is artificial, which is, as all of you will know, that's what Mr. Putin has said about Ukraine, that it's an artificial state. That is exactly what Hitler said about multiple European states, Austria, Czechoslovakia, and Poland, all three of which were destroyed with increasing violence in the onset to the Second World War. It is also, incidentally, what Stalin said about Poland in 1939. That Poland was an artificial state, it never should have existed, and its population includes our ethnic brethren that we have to cross the border to rescue. That kind of atrocity talk, which Putin has now used to try to somehow explain this invasion, that atrocity talk is familiar also from both Hitler and Stalin in 1938. In 1939. The idea, an imagination, right, an entirely imaginary threat where you say a country that is actually more tolerant, much more tolerant than mine, I'm going to accuse that country of intolerance and atrocity. That is what Hitler did, right? German speakers in Austria were freer than German speakers in Germany in 1938. Russian speakers in Ukraine are much freer in every respect than Russian speakers in Russia. But there is that same trick, right? This notion that I'm going to imagine an atrocity across the border. So the Mr. Putin's speeches have, they're not about history, of course, they're about a kind of myth, but they have this character, as I think Serhii quite rightly says, that when you deny the existence of a nation and a state, what you are doing is asserting your own right to destroy that nation and that state. This is a very important point which Hannah Arendt makes in Origins of Totalitarianism. The language that a totalitarian leader uses to describe the world is there in order to bend the world into that shape. So of course, I mean, it's a banal truth, but I'll repeat it. Of course, there is a Ukrainian state, and that Ukrainian state, I have to say, has proven to be remarkably functional under incredible stress. The Ukrainian tax authorities are still functional enough to issue a statement saying that if you happen to claim a Russian armored vehicle or tank and bring it to your farm, you will not be taxed for it. The Ukrainian nation, as Serhii has already said, it's not that it didn't exist before, but I mean, what more proof does one need? It's not just that people are fighting. And when, I mean, can you imagine? I mean, just imagine the physical courage involved, the physical and moral courage involved in resisting an invasion by Russia. It's extraordinary. But all the people who aren't fighting, who are active in what we call, in a phrase which is somehow too light for this moment, what we call civil society, all the people who are doing some little thing. When I speak to my Ukrainian friends, I mean, when I manage to catch them, that there are many commonalities. One of the commonalities is that they all manage to calm me down rather than the other way around. And another one of the commonalities is that they're all doing something. They're all doing something for someone else, right? And that, like, that is what is meant by being a nation. A nation is not about a declaration. It's not about some idiotic story about the past. A nation is about the future. It's about being able to do things together. So there was a French historian, a brilliant French historian called Jules Michelet, who described the nation as a daily plebiscite. Right? So the nation is about what you go out and do every day. It's about what you say and what you do every day. It's how you leave a trace. So, you know, this competition of stories, it's a competition, as I see it, of different kinds of stories. So it's not as though one is directly aligned against the other. There's a story which is a kind of gray, pale story about non-existence. You know, the story that all of the past points in one direction, and that one direction is that there can't be a Ukraine, there can't be a state, there can't be a nation. And then there's another kind of story which doesn't address that directly. I mean, one of the things I'm struck by, I mean, there are plenty of Ukrainians who can address all these things directly, but what I'm struck by is that their story is just, it's orthogonal, it's somewhere else. Their story is about existence, right? It's about subjectivity. It's about being now, right? In this 21st century. So it's not exactly a rebuttal, you know, to that story. It's just it's a different mode of expression. And I think, like, I'm sure we'll have a chance to talk about Ukrainian history, since you have two historians of Ukraine, and, you know, the chair of Ukrainian history at Harvard on the panel. But I think it's very important to recognize that. This doesn't come down to who really, you know, when a Viking warlord called Valdemar baptized himself maybe 1,000 years ago after having flirted with Islam and Judaism and Western Christianity. You know, when a Viking warlord called Valdemar married a Byzantine princess, even though he already had 8 wives, or maybe it was 6, and 800 concubines, or maybe it was 600, that moment didn't define whether Russia and Ukraine and Belarus are, you know, it's not about disputing the meaning of Valdemar baptizing himself, right? That's not what this is really about. A story, because here's the thing, the story that is told by Mr. Putin about how a baptism 1,000 years ago, and I've tried to give you some of the colorful details because it's the colorful details that remind us what history and life are really like, right? But this kind of story that Mr. Putin is telling is a basically fascist story. It's a story about how once upon a time, nothing was fragmented. There was purity. Someone got baptized. There was water. They were purified. Everything was purified. And his name was Vladimir. And my name is also Vladimir. That is quite literally the story. That is the story. It has been said in basically so many words. He's also said that the length of 7,000 words in a published paper. But that is basically the story. And that is a fascist story. The story that the world was once united, the story that the world was once united and pure, but it has been fragmented and broken by outsiders. That is Mr. Putin's version. The version is that everything which is Ukraine comes from outside. It's the Poles, it's the Germans, it's the Austrians, it's the Americans. That's all artificial. And so if you can just strip that away, then you come back to the real story. The unity, this imagination that he has about the last 1,000 years. The thing is, his story of the last 1,000 years has everything in it except for the facts. And in order to strip away the facts, as Serhii quite rightly said, you have to strip away the people. You have to kill all the people who have been produced by history as it actually has been. You have to physically eliminate all of the variety which allows people to speak of belonging to a nation and doing the small things that make a nation real. And that is the relationship between Putin's story and this invasion. It is about getting rid of the Ukrainian nation as it has actually been created by history and trying to move towards this vision of purity where there's no contingency left, there's no difference left, there's no variety left. There's just this kind of what Mr. Putin himself calls this kind of historical unity. So that's one kind of story and where it leads. And so that's why I wanted to stress that it isn't a battle of stories in the sense that we have to decide what that baptism 1,000 years ago really meant. I think it's more important to recognize that there's one kind of story which leads in this horribly homogenizing direction, which justifies violence. And then there's a different kind of story which is basically saying, we're here. We're here.
So what does this moment mean for the West and its image of itself?
We've talked a bit already about how this resembles 1938 or 1939, and Serhii's made the point that one has to address this differently than one addressed 1938 in Czechoslovakia or 2014 in the Donbass, if one wants to, I'll make the point slightly more strongly, if one wants to get to the 22nd century at all, if we're going to get across this century. But it's not just, so we're making these comparisons in a kind of pragmatic, low-key way, but it seems to me that for the European Union in particular, it's very important to see that their whole conceptualization of the Second World War is now under active assault. So there's an obvious way in which this is true, and that is that there's a war going on, and there shouldn't be a war going on. And European integration is supposed to prevent war, and now we have a war which is whatever your definition is, it's a terrible war of aggression and destruction. But in addition to that, there is a contestation of vocabulary which has a great deal to do with whether and how Europeans and others are going to be able to think about the future. And it has to do with the end of the Second World War, with the outcome of the Second World War, with how we judge the Second World War. And what I have in mind is Mr. Putin's attempt to appropriate the basic concepts of that Europeans and others have used to try to understand and then build a moral and institutional infrastructure around the Second World War. Concepts such as genocide, concepts such as Nazi, concepts such as tribunal. In Mr. Putin's declaration of war a couple of Thursdays ago, and in a number of statements since, what he has done has been to claim that this war is about, and I hate to even repeat this because it's so absurd and grotesque and it's such a moral atrocity, honestly, that this concept is even in the world, but that what he means to do is to denazify Ukraine. Now, that is horrible in a factual way, of course, because it's a country with democratic elections. It's the only country, you know, and as historians, they tell us never to predict things, but I'm going to predict this. It's the only country that's going to elect a Jewish president with 73% of the vote. That's not going to happen again. None of you is ever going to see that in a country besides Israel, which has a certain affirmative action advantage in this respect. You are never going to see another country elect a Jewish president with 73% of the vote. It's not going to happen. That's Ukrainian history. That's not going to be anybody else's history. So this idea is factually grotesque, but its deeper problem is that it is a weapon directed at you. It's a weapon directed at the European conceptualization of this war. because its aims are not just to mischaracterize the world, but to alter the world in a way where all of your characterizations will no longer make sense. If you characterize the world in this way, and then you carry out the threat, that is, you know, God forbid, you win the war, and you round up the Ukrainian intelligentsia, you round up all of the people who in some way stand for Ukraine. If you do that, and this is, I'm just saying what Mr. Putin says his war aims are, right? His war aims are the destruction of the Ukrainian state and nation, and he's explicitly called for tribunals to deal with these people. So if he does that, that's not just horrible on its own. It is a kind of war of aggression on European memory, because he's taking the words Nazi and genocide, and not just making them meaningless, he's debasing them, he's perverting them. His claim is that those words mean whatever I say they mean. There is no connection between signifier and signified, no connection between rhetoric and reality. He is making the claim that I, as the leader of Russia, define those words. And by extension, those words mean nothing besides power. There are no words, you have no words in your language to defy power. I'm going to take the basic words that you have taken from the 1940s. I'm going to take Nazis and genocide. I'm going to take those words away from you. I'm going to take the words which are at the far extreme of describing a moral world, and I'm going to take them from you. I'm going to put them in the category of words that just mean what power says that they mean. So, and this, of course, this logic continues with the idea of tribunals. If there are trials, as Mr. Putin, again, I'm just quoting him, if there are trials, as he says they will be, what are those trials? Those trials are deliberate perversions of Nuremberg. They are deliberate sham tribunals defined to take not just our vocabulary of atrocity and debase it, but also the very institutions like the rule of law, the application of the rule of law, and debase them, pervert them, put them on trial, so to speak, make them look ridiculous. So not just to commit an atrocity, but to commit an atrocity which makes judging atrocity seem absurd. So this, I'm trying to say, is now a competing interpretation of the Second World War, which says that the meaning of the Second World War is that the leader of Russia has the capability to describe anyone he wants as Nazis, to accuse anyone he wants of genocide, and that if he succeeds in doing that and destroying a nation and bringing people to trial and so on, then all that vocabulary, all those institutions, all of the psychological and moral basis upon which the European Union has been built, that's all gone. That is all gone. And so when Europeans are facing this war, they have to think, what can we do in response to that? And now I'm slowly moving to the future. It is, I think, not enough to say, we learned from the Second World War. Maybe you did, but there has to be a reaffirmation of whatever it was that you learned from the Second World War now, a practical reaffirmation. Because let's say that it's actually true that Europeans learned from the Second World War and that brought about this process of European integration. If that were true, if that proposition were true, it would then certainly logically follow that when there is a war of destruction on this scale, the process of European integration would be extended to the country that is the victim of that war. And if European leaders and publics, and by the way, republics seem to be thinking the way that I'm thinking. Republics seem to be ahead of leaders on this question of whether Ukraine should be a member of the European Union. But if it's true that Europe learned something from the Second World War and that the European Union is a response to the Second World War, if that is true, then it would certainly follow that Ukraine would be offered membership in the European Union now. And if it is not, if there is no active response from the European Union, if the European Union does not affirm itself when facing a war in 2022, as opposed to a war in 1942, it's relatively easy to face a war in 1942. It's relatively easy to talk about what you learned from that war. But if it's true at all that there was learning from that war, if that tradition is actually true, I put a question mark behind this, then the war in 2022 has to be a war that by which, through which, as a result of which, European integration is confirmed. And if you don't do that, it's a little bit like asking the question, what would have happened if the Ukrainians hadn't defended their country? If you don't defend the notion of Europe as a peace project, if you don't defend the legacy of learning from the Second World War by also learning from this war, then you have lost the competition for what the Second World War actually means. You will have lost it to someone who says the Second World War is an argument for more war. That is what is at stake. In Mr. Putin's declaration of war a couple of Thursdays ago, and in a number of statements since, what he has done has been to claim that this war is about, and I hate to even repeat this because it's so absurd and grotesque and it's such a moral atrocity, honestly, that this concept is even in the world. Every justification that's been given for this invasion just makes it worse. The truth is what you're willing to take a risk for. Truth is what you're willing to put yourself behind. In Mr. Putin's declaration of war a couple of Thursdays ago, and in a number of statements since, what he has done has been to claim that this war is about, and I hate to even repeat this because it's so absurd and grotesque and it's such a moral atrocity, honestly, that this concept is even in the world. Every justification that's been given for this invasion just makes it worse.